Sri Ganeshaya Namaha. Om Vakratunda Mahakaya Suryakoti Samaprabha Nirvignam Kurume Deva Sarvakaryeshu Sarvadam. Om Ganganapatiye Namaha. Greetings and welcome to this edition of Thursday Morning Live. I will start by saying that we live in a world that is modulated by time, space, and causation. And I personally am very interested in this because this year will be the 30th year since I met Mr. Pilskog after I published Agora. I got a letter from him. This, young people, was back in the day before email. This was when you actually had to put stamps on letters and put them into the post box, and then by some method that is still kind of obscure, they would get to the place where you wanted them to go. So he sent me a letter, and he said he would be interested if we could meet. And I was going to Seattle anyway to lecture about Ayurveda. And so I started, when I was there next, I met him, and we became friendly, and I started staying with him whenever I was in Seattle, which was two or three times a year, which I did for the ensuing 22 years until he and his wife moved down here. And now we still see one another twice a year, but for longer periods since we are in a larger space and with longer time. So it was a great pleasure to be able to experiment with doing an event like this, where he would be doing part of it and I would be doing part of it. And as you may have seen, he has his own way of doing things, and I have my own way of doing things. And so far, generally speaking, they have complemented one another. So hopefully they will continue to complement one another. Because fundamentally and basically, our approach to things is similar in that it is a desirable thing to be able to perceive reality as clearly as possible, and the reality that we see with the help of our sense organs, of course, is the only reality that we can that we as organisms can practically experience, because we as organisms employ those sense organs to provide for us an image of the world. So when people talk about Maya, my mentor used to say that Maya was the skin of the world. And it's the skin of the world because it's the impression that's provided to us that allows us to have an image of what's going on outside. It is not what's going on outside, because it's been selected by the sense organs, and it's been calculated, and it has been presented to the internal awareness on the basis of calculations that are happening in the conscious mind and the subconscious mind and also the unconscious mind. And all of these together provides us our darshana. Darshana meaning both literally in Sanskrit vision, and also our philosophy, our way of seeing the world, our filter that allows us to extract things that appear to be meaningful and ignore things that appear at that moment to be less meaningful. And the more clearly that one can see reality and understand what's going on behind the skin of the mango, behind the skin of the world, and the more accurately one can see behind the vast pervasion of all the different manifestations of different varieties of reality, to the fact that there is a behind all of that kind of reality that is not limited by time, space, or causation, that is regarded by many people, including me, to be a desirable thing. People talk about Tantra or Tantra, and I'm very interested in the way that words get derived, as a Sanskrit. The Sanskrit grammar is based on roots and words that emerge from those roots. And the word Tantra emerged from the root Tana, which means to extend. It can mean also to weave. A word that comes from that same root as Tanu, which means the body. So something that's extended, something that's been woven together, is the Tanu. And Tantra is a process of weaving. It is a process of taking threads, and those would be threads of Shakti in whatever kind of form that you decide you want to employ that Shakti, and to weave them together to create an effect of some kind. It would be an understatement to say that Tantra is generally misunderstood. Here in the West, people equate it with good sex yoga. In India, most people don't even think about that. When they hear the word Tantra, they think of black magic. Because in the same way that over here, people who think they're studying and practicing Tantra often get off into good sex yoga. In India, you may start practicing Tantra in a positive way, but you might find yourself tempted by the things that you can procure by employing it in a less desirable way, in a way that sometimes actually either simulates or actually becomes black magic. The very idea of Tantra being magic is, magic, if we define magic, I think one definition that I like for that is that the production of effects by means other than the obvious. So you're still employing usually some kind of technique for this purpose, except in very unusual, spontaneous cases. And that technique may be one that is it's providing cause, and the effects that you procure from that technique may not be something that, according to your common sense, would be things that would emerge, but may emerge anyway. Many people who define Tantra, and really there is no one definition of it, because Tantra is not a philosophy so much as a practical way of figuring out how to do things and doing them. Finding results that you want to achieve, achieving those results, and moving ahead. One definition of Tantra, and it was one that my mentor would use frequently, though not exclusively, was that Tantra was all about Bhuta Shuddhi. Shuddhi means purification, and Bhuta, in this case, particularly means the Mahabhutas, the five elements that the Sankhya philosophy talks about in that from which the manifested universe is created: earth, water, fire, air, and space. But Bhuta literally means anything that has been created. So anything that you've created in yourself, anything that has been created externally, everything that's part of the already created creation, to purify that so it's not interfering with your perception of what's going on. Not interfering with your ability to connect to that reality that is not limited by time, space, and causation, that reality that's not limited by color and form and all of the other things that we in our sense that we can perceive with our sense organs, and simply by the effect of perceiving, that perception itself has a tendency to make us believe that those things are real. It's only practical because you have sense organs, because you have to find things to eat, you have to avoid becoming dinner for something else. You have sense organs because you want to obtain cues about the world for important things that relate to you protecting yourself. But the very fact that the sense organs are not only pointed externally to pay attention to the environment, but they are charged to react quickly against what's going on in the environment, to provide you to get the opportunity to get the food before anybody else does, or to run faster in front of the tiger, faster than whoever is behind you, so that you'll be less likely to be consumed. That factor in the interaction between the senses and their objects, that factor that causes you to have great confidence in the veracity of your senses, that's one of those things that makes it difficult for you to be able to have confidence in your intuition, to have confidence in a reality of awareness that is not predicated on your senses, because so repeatedly over so many hundreds of millions of years, the senses have proved useful for protecting you against the things that you needed to be protected from and for providing you the things that you needed to be provided with. So everything that is being perceived by the senses, at least in an ordinary human being, is something that's already been created. Most of the things have been created out of the five Mahabhutas, the five great elements, but a lot of it has been created out of your mind also. Perceptions that you've had that have been worked on by your awareness and memories that you have and memes that may have lodged themselves in your mind and possibly things that other ethereal beings, which can in Sanskrit generally be referred to as Bhuta as well. Everything that was alive and is now not alive. Everything, even if it was never alive, but that was created, that can interact with you in some way. All of these things are Bhutas. But the most important five Bhutas that we have that we want to purify for the purpose of being able to perceive things accurately are the five Mahabhutas from which the world is created, because they are the five things that our sense organs are trying to connect to when they are trying to connect to things. The earth element relates, of course, to everything that is solid under normal conditions, and solid things are stable. So the earth element is very valuable. That's why we're sitting on earth element, because it's stable. But it's also not so valuable because it is too stable. Where there is stability, there is tamas. You know the word tamas. You're familiar with that word. So it is also the case that if you've studied Sankhya, you know that the sense organs, relatively speaking, compared to everything else in the environment, your sense organs are chiefly associated with sattva. And the five Mahabhutas are created out of tamas, in fact. So when your sense organs connect to something that's made out of the five Mahabhutas, including this bottle of water, for example, when your six sense organs connect with this, they are connecting with something that's created out of the five Mahabhutas, so that's tamas right there. And this, you're connecting with something that you are relating to as a thing, you are relating to as an object. You're projecting your awareness onto it as an object, and that is magnifying the tamas in the thing. Because you as sattva, you are saying, I am the subject, and that is the object. So you are separating things. Subject means I'm taking the sattva onto myself, and tamas means I'm pushing the object, means I'm pushing the objectivity, the separateness from me, the non-sattva is all going over here. Rajas is just moving things back and forth. So simply by virtue of perceiving this, not only are you perceiving this and you were taking in tamas into your awareness because it is a thing, but also because you are perceiving it as a thing. If you were able to perceive it as simply, this is one more sensory perception that I'm not going to allow myself to do anything other than perceive it to the degree in which I need to perceive it, then it would have less of an effect of bringing tamas into your awareness. The fact is, however, that the more you use your sense organs, the more you are inviting tamas into your awareness, the more that you are encouraging tamas to be present. And this is why in one of the Ayurvedic texts, it says very clearly that once your mind has become tired of going outside of itself and picking up sensory impressions, then it stops doing that and it starts to project internally, and that's when you go to sleep. The reason why you're going to sleep, I mean, yes, it's because partly because the mind is tired, but it's also because you've accumulated, and sleep is very much associated with tamas, because there you are lying down inert, may as well be dead. Sleep is associated with tamas, and the fact is that when you've accumulated, when you brought in all of this extra tamas from the outside all day long, there comes a point where you have so much tamas that the sattva can't function anymore because it is drowning in a sea of tamas. And then you have to go to sleep so all the tamas can get digested and dissipated and so on. And then you can wake up again and start the whole process all over. And years go by and then you die. Unless you have elected to try to find out what is going on in the system and look behind the curtain and see the man behind the curtain and notice that in fact he is not the great and powerful Oz, but it is simply part of this mechanism that's been generated by nature over a period of hundreds of millions of years for the purpose of attempting to come up with ways to reflect reality in a much more effective fashion. So in order to be able to do that, the better we are able to use the sense organs, but to use them in a way that is not the sense organ consuming us, it's we employing the sense organ. It is suggested that purifying the elements is a good idea. So we want to purify the stability of the earth element in such a way that it will still be stable for us, but that we're not taking in so much tamas that it is causing a disturbance to our own internal awareness. So what we are trying to do really is find a way to be able to possess the earth. Why are we employing the earth element? Why are we so happy about there being earth element here? Because we need stability. The more that you can awaken the earth element inside yourself and find stability inside yourself, the less you need the earth element externally. Practically speaking, it's always going to be more convenient to actually sit on something stable. Sitting on water, less, you know, on your waterbed, less enjoy, sitting on a current, the compressed air being the not so stable, and definitely sitting on fire, we don't suggest that. And we're not even going to talk about sitting on space because there's no on to sit on in space. Space is everywhere. The only practical thing you can sit on is the earth element, and you want to have the earth element available to you. If you and the earth element get into a good relationship, you will find that the earth element is always assisting you to do what it needs to do for you. So even if you are in a rocky area, you will find some sort of nice place where you can plop yourself down and feel stable for the length of time that you need to be there, with the intention, eventually, that there will be enough of a good relationship between you and the earth element that you might not even require the earth element anymore. Perhaps you would be able to maintain your sangfroid even by levitating above the ground. That might not be something that you have an ambition for. It might not be something that you will achieve in the space of one lifetime. But it's still worth being aware of the fact that there is no need to project the earth element externally and rely on its external support if you can, in fact, find internal support from the earth element and employ it that way. This applies to all of the elements. The water element, for example, relates to everything that is liquid in life, but that includes everything that is liquid in the world, our bodies, 60 to 75% water. Water itself, alcohol, soup, the taste in general, the tastes in the mouth, the tastes in the body, emotions of all kinds are watery things. They're all, the Sanskrit word rasa applies to all of these aspects of the liquid reality of life. So we have the earth element existing in ourselves, in our awarenesses, in the form of the stability, the dhriti or the dhairya, the stability that we have to possess inside our beings to be able to maintain our personalities, to maintain our awareness of what we're trying to do, to maintain the direction in which we're going. And the liquid element that appears externally in so many different physical forms appears internally in physical form, but also appears internally in the form of the emotions, which are also as much as the water externally are under the control of the moon, and just like they do in the ocean, come in waves, and when the organism gets flooded with emotion, even after the flood goes away, there's still mud lying around frequently. So when we're trying to purify the water element, we're understanding that the literal water element in the body, like all of the elements in the body, need to be able to circulate. The water element, of course, more than anything else needs to circulate, particularly because the water element has to move all the other elements around. It has to move the earth element from place to place and keep the earth element suspended in the water so it does not precipitate out and create gallstones or kidney stones or something like that. And it has to be not too diffuse. It has to be just the right amount of concentration, the right amount of earth in the water to make sure that whatever needs to get done gets done. And the water has to have the right relationship with fire, because, of course, water and fire don't really go together at all. They don't like one another. But you have to have stomach acid is fire and water. Enzymes, pancreatic enzymes are fire and water. Bile is liquid form of fire. So many different liquid forms of fire, but they have to be not too hot, and they have to be not too cold. They have to be just concentrated to the right degree in order for them to be able to do the job that they need to do. And they also need to have the right quantity, and they have to be in the right place at the right time. And this, of course, applies to emotions also. They should all be in the right quantity, and they should be in the right place at the right time, and they should be flowing nicely. And they should be, when they are crescendoing, they should not crescendo too high, and they should not crescendo too low. They should be just at the right area where they can be surfed upon instead of being ended up under. So the liquid element has to be purified. And of course, the liquid element is the most important element we have in the physical body. And therefore, it is something that many tantrics have concentrated on strongly. And that is why alchemy is a big part of Tantra, and tantric alchemy is called rasa vidya, the knowledge of rasa. So it's, and the concept is that if you actually want to succeed in alchemy, and the test is, at least in India, the test is gagana gamana and suvarna karana. You should be able to fly in the air and turn base metal into gold. So if you can do those two things, you have succeeded at external alchemy. And the assumption is that if you're able to do that, you will have undergone sufficient of an internal transformation that you would be able to, you would be perfectly positioned for achieving internal alchemy as well. Though, as we have, as is so often the case, when you start becoming able to achieve things in the physical world, it's very tempting to focus on continuing achieving things in the physical world, and then you often will get dragged out of your intention to go further inside because of the fact that success is encouraging forward movement into the pravritti rather than into the nivritti. So controlling the water element is, of course, not an easy thing, but purifying the water element is the place where you have to start if you want to have any ability for the water element to work in your favor. Purifying the fire element is important because, of course, the fire element is the thing that converts the earth and water on the one hand into air and space on the other hand, or that converts air and space into earth and water. It's the fulcrum between the two less dense elements and the two denser elements. The fire is, of course, the foundation of the Vedic, I suppose we could call it a religion. It became a religion, but originally it was no more a religion than any other method of trying to obtain reality, knowledge about reality. It was simply a path that was being followed. But the first word of the first verse of the first hymn of the first mandala of the first of the Vedas, the first word is Agni, which means the fire. So that's the basis of the entire Veda is the fire, putting things into the fire and having the fire transport them into the non-physical world and then have the non-physical world respond in what hopefully will be a desirable way. So purifying the fire element is very important especially because if you're trying to get into the non-physical reality, you will have to make sure that there is enough of the fire element that is working in a positive way in the physical reality for you to continue staying alive and functioning and wandering around and not being a burden on everybody that you know. And there has to be enough transformation of that, the physiological fire, into subtle fire, into the form of fire less subjected to the forces of evolution that have caused it to evolve into things like bile and enzymes and acid and so on, all these melanin and all these other things that are functioning as representatives of the fire in the physiological existence. So purification of the air element, of course, is something that is a big part of the Patanjali's yoga under the name pranayama. The air element, as it appears in the physiological organism, does what the air element does externally. It moves things around. The job of air is to move. It has to move continuously inside. If it is not continuously moving, then it is going to be doing something undesirable. As long as it's moving in the places, in the channels in which it should be moving, at the rate at which it should be moving, at the time at which it should be moving, then it will do its job properly. So first, as with all the elements, but particularly with the element of air, you want to make sure that first all of the channels in which the organism, in which the air circulates in your organism, that those channels have been mostly purified, because then there will be less obstruction when you are trying to encourage the air to circulate in a particular way. You will I believe I heard yesterday that John explained that, you know, the tri shula, a shula means a spear in Sanskrit. It also means colicky pain. All Sanskrit words have many meanings behind them. Colicky pain, I expect, because if you were to be stabbed with a spear, this would provide you great discomfort, very similar to being stabbed when your colon is, and after all, colic comes from colon. So spasm in a tubular organ is colic. You can have colic because of the ureter, there's a stone gets here, colic because of the bile duct, something gets stuck there. But it has to be a tubular organ for it to be colic. So the proper circulation of the air in the organism happens because of chiefly the three big, not only, but chiefly the three biggest nadis, the biggest channels in the organism, the sushumna, which is the central channel, the ida, with the left channel, and the pingala, the right channel. Ida and pingala are always shifting from one to another. They're except just before dawn and right at dusk. Those are times when it's easier to get sushumna to work because the two nostrils tend to work together at that time. The rest of the day, they're shifting back and forth. Theoretically, they should be shifting back and forth every hour and a half, but if that was ever true, it certainly isn't true nowadays because there are too many other influences on people that are disturbing that from happening. And that would be the case also only if your nasal septum was nice and straight and there was nothing, your sinuses were nice and open and there were no physiological obstructions to what might be causing the breath to move in or out. And of course, it would depend on whether you were more introverted or more extroverted. So if you're more introverted, definitely you're always going to be, you're going to be encouraging the left nostril to work more, and more extroverted mentally, you're going to be, the nostrils may be doing their thing, but mentally you're going to be thinking, I want to express myself. I have to make it, and then over here, I don't want to. This is all going on without you being aware of it much of the time. This is happening at a non-conscious level, but it's all part of what's going on underneath. And it doesn't necessarily need, you need to use your rational mind to change it, but you may need to use your rational mind to get your rational mind out of the way of it so at least you can perceive what's going on and encouraging those things to become more balanced in a positive way. The two major channels that we are using most of the time, Ida and Pingala, left and right, etc., making them more balanced will encourage the proper functioning of all three. And so this is why one of the methods for encouraging purification of the nadis, they call nadi shuddhi. And that is performed by inhaling through the left nostril and exhaling through the right, and inhaling through the right and exhaling through the left. And yes, you can use your fingers to do that. You can torture your nostrils that way. That may be a good way to begin, but an even better way to continue is to use your awareness, because your prana will always follow your awareness. Wherever you move your awareness in your organism, your prana is going to move there too. So if you take your awareness and you encourage your awareness and you tell your awareness that you want to inhale through your left nostril and you want to exhale through the right, and you're employing your attention to envision yourself inhaling through the right and exhaling through the left, you will find at some point, which we will not predict when that might happen, but you will find that actually that will start happening. And it's happening because your attention is directing your prana to do that. It may take time, but it definitely, if you are consistent and persistent, then it will occur. But why this is good is because you are encouraging those two to balance one another. Not that they should be breathing, you should be breathing out of one nostril for one breath and one for the next breath. That would be way too disturbing. All you're doing is you're sending a message that you want them to balance one another, and then you should back off and let them balance one another as they want to. So when we are talking about purifying the five elements, we need to remember that we have expressed our, yes, I want to purify the five elements. But you as an ordinary human being and me as an ordinary human being, we don't exactly know how to do that. So what we're saying is that, oh, supreme reality of the experience of the cosmos and all the multiverse, I would like to move in this direction, and I'm going to perform this, and it is my intention that this should assist me in moving in that direction. Please, please, please help me out. Thank you. So you're trying to do something that you have been told is going to purify yourself, but what you're actually doing is something that you're performing to encourage your organism to purify itself. You're trying to encourage the organism to move in the direction of being more purified, and you'll have to keep going back to find out whether that's happening. My point being that you can't simply become a great expert at torturing your nostrils, and now you can do this and that, and you can then start doing all kinds of fancy things. And that may be amusing, but that is not necessarily achieving the result that you want to achieve. Yes, it may have achieved this result, but that's not necessarily purifying your nadis. It may, in fact, be creating some structure that is going to cause you further problems later on. So it's good not to get too caught up in a vision of how things are and should be, or a concept about about technique and what technique is able to achieve, or what you're planning for the technique to do, or just better not to get caught up in any of that stuff. Remain calm, relax, breathe a lot, and if there's question, assume that everything you know is wrong. Which brings us to the element of akasha, or space, or it used to be called ether. And of course, akasha in the most refined version means the space in which everything is taking place, the fabric of space itself, the quantum mechanical field, the vacuum energy, whatever you want to call it. It's the thing from which all of the particles that make up our universe have emerged, from which periodically particles spontaneously emerge, even now. Hundreds of thousands of times every second, particles are emerging. Most of them find their antiparticles and resolve back into the field, but some do not do that, and then they become independent particles, and then they wander around the universe and they get involved in the manifestation, and then they are there until they aren't there anymore. So the universe is continuously, from the very fabric of space-time, it's continuing to, instant by instant, produce more of what we have here, more of manifested, externally manifested space and time, and energy and matter. The word akasha, kasha means to shine. The city of Benares in India is called Kashi because it is a luminous city, the city of light. Akasha indicates something that is shining, it's glowing, but it's, of course, not glowing in a way that you and I can perceive it, because it's much more subtle than air, which is more subtle than fire, which is more subtle than water, which is more subtle than earth. So akasha is the most subtle of all the five elements, but it is always good to remember that it is still an element. It's still a tangible thing. It's still a manifested thing. It is still matter. This is where the modern physics and ancient physics diverge, because modern physics suggests that there's nothing behind that field, whereas ancient physics suggests that, in fact, once you get to that field, you have to go behind it in order to get to where all of that originated from, the awareness from where matter and energy actually emerged. So that's an important reason why we want to have purification of the elements, because we want them to be able to, we want to be able not to have the elements interfere with our ability to perceive that with our inner awareness, not with our external awareness, because that externalized awareness can only connect to externalized objects. So our inner awareness can connect to that inner, base field of Akasha, and then go behind that to what it is that creates Akasha in the first place. And that brings us to the five tanmatras. Do you know the word tanmatra? Tanmatra, there are five tanmatras: shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, and gandha. And these are five the word tanmatra literally means that portion. So that portion of the field of tamas. We're in the field of tamas now. We're in the field of things that are sufficiently stable that they can be perceived. And so in that field of tamas, there are five portions that are going to be perceived by the five sense organs. And those five portions are shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, and gandha. Shabda means sound. Sparsha means touch. Rupa means form. Rasa means taste. And gandha means odor. So these are the things that we're actually, that our sense organs are actually connecting to. The sense organ of hearing, when it hears something, is actually connecting to sound. But it's, we, because of the fact that our sense organs are connected to our physical bodies, when we hear a sound, we tend to allow the sense organ of hearing to connect to the physical manifestation of that sound, rather than to, in addition to doing that, connect to the impulse that caused that physical manifestation to occur. So the physical manifestation is occurring. For example, the sound in my voice is happening because I am larynx is vibrating in a particular way, and it's moving the physiological manifested air in the space here, and those waves are getting to your ear and you're hearing them. But that's really all just the transmission of the sound that is being produced. Not, it's being produced in the most in the densest way by this method. By this method that is that's manifesting itself in the field of the five elements. Whereas sound and in the field of what is behind Akasha does not require physical manifestation to propagate. It's happening in a more refined space. It's happening, in fact, in a giant space that is made out of all possible sounds. And out of that giant space, that is not really space because it is beyond what we think of as space. Once you get beyond the concept of the quantum mechanical field, it's hard to visualize what might be there, because for our sense organs, that's as far as our sense organs can go. So we can only, it's as if, and this is why, you know, there have been, for example, so much has been communicated about the syllable om. And you will have people who go on and on about how there's a plus u plus ma, and that's creation and preservation and destruction. And then after om, there's m, and then the m gets nasalized, and that's the anuspada. If you see an om, where's your om shirt? It's not here. The moment when we needed it. It was there earlier anyway, you know. Ah, there we are. And there is the om. So you see, there is the om. And then there, here's the om thing. And then there's this little half moon thing. And that's the Anunasika or the Chandrika. And that represents the fact that you take the om and then you nasalize it. Om. And then there's the bindu. So the bindu is the sound that comes when you're not hearing any sound with your physical ear, but the sound is still emerging, and it's emerging from that point from which the entire universe emerged, and it's emerging in the form of the word that is perceptible by us initially only when it is manifested in the world of the five elements, but ideally should be perceived before it is manifested in that field of five elements. And if you can do that, then you're perceiving it at the level of shabda, at the level of sound itself, which is why sometimes they say that the people who follow that path to get back to the supreme reality of no qualities and no dimensions and none of that kind of stuff, they say that they are following the path of the shabda brahman, brahman meaning supreme reality, and shabda meaning the nada, the sound that is more subtle than all the sounds that are manifested by normal methods. So sparsha means similarly the touch that is not, that you don't require the sense organ of, that you don't require your skin to experience. And rupa, or form, form is what the eye actually sees. We think that we are seeing something that is solid, but the eye doesn't see this as, it may tell us that it is, or our experience may tell us that it's solid, but someone who has not had that experience yet will look at it, and it is simply part of this general field of form. It starts off being form, and then as we learn more about it, then we project onto it. If I was to see this, I would assume that this was in fact filled with liquid water. It could very, for all I know, be filled with some sort of complicated holographic projection mechanism that's making me believe that it's filled with water. But I am convinced that it is filled with water because I've had so many experiences of it so long in the past because I don't want to try to reinvent the wheel, or in this case the water bottle, I will just assume that that's what this is because I have had previous experience, and I'm allowing my tumas to convince me that that's what this is. But it's, after all, if it was a really well-made holograph, then I would try to grab hold of it and would not be there. Even though I had convinced myself that in fact it was there, that it had heft, I would be believing, I would be projecting on it that it had this much roughly weight to it, when in fact it might not if it was nothing but a hologram. So form is what the eye sees. Everything else that we apply to the form is being applied by previous experience, by assumptions, by all kinds of other things that are happening, that are we are concocting back here, in order to allow us to move through the world of form as efficiently as we can. Of the five senses for human beings, sight is the most important. It's the thing that provides us really with the ability to seriously believe that all of this that we see out external to us is actually there. Hearing and touch, all these things are important, but it's sight that really for us is the thing that brings it all together. And hence the emphasis that the Vedic people put on the fire element, because with the help of the fire element, the job of the fire element is to take things from this world and make that are physical and make them non-physical,
or at least less physical. You will end up with some ash, which is more physical, but the rest of it will have been de-physicalized. So part of what you're doing when you worship the fire is you're trying to purify your perception of your organ of vision, not just your eyes, but your organ of vision, so that your organ of vision will be able to see the forms that are beyond or behind or anterior to or subtle to the forms that the organ of vision is not only perceiving but projecting onto. So, purification of the five elements is all about purification of the senses so that they can perceive the subtle objects first. Because then you have to go from there to be able to perceive tamas and rajas and sattva, and then go from there to perceive ahankara, go from there to perceive mahat, and then the prakriti, and then the purusha, and then beyond the and so on. But we have to start from somewhere, so we start from here. And there are many ways to purify the five elements, because what you're trying to do is, of course, you're not the elements themselves have accreted to you because you had to be born in the world in an organism that would permit you to be able to interact with the world in a positive way so you could survive long enough to be able to understand other stuff. And as a human being, why, I hear a tiny human being over there somewhere. As a human being, and I believe you, as a new father, can testify to this, a young human being is completely dependent on other human beings for a long, long time.
I testify.
He is testifying to that. And we were having a discussion the other day as to what was the minimum age a human being could be when they could be off taking care of themselves on their own. And we came to the general conclusion that the unusual 8-year-old, maybe, if they'd been well trained, could spend a certain amount of time actually on their own and survive. But that would be the really unusual way. But even if 10, 12, and we're talking years and years and years and years, and during that period of time, the people who are taking care of us are also projecting their versions of reality onto us. We're seeing things as they do, and it's practical for us to do that, because if we don't see things the way they do, then they may just decide to leave us in the forest somewhere and find somebody new. Because, especially in the past, nowadays it's different, but in the past, you had your clan and your family and so on, and everybody needed to be on the same wavelength at least most of the time if you wanted as a clan to survive. So if you were not part of a group, it would be much easier for you to be jettisoned when it was starting to be necessary to toss things overboard so the ship did not sink. And this is why there's scientific evidence to suggest that babies are cutest at age 1, when the parents have not had insufficient sleep for an entire year, and they're starting to think of possibly doing a Moses or a Karna or a Kabir, and putting the little tyke into a large river and hoping that he would find someone who is willing to take care of him. But at that moment, if the child is very, very cute, then the parents will again sort of melt and think, and then return to taking care of it for the next... nowadays, the children go off to college and then come back with their student loans and live in their parents' house at least until age... at least 26... 30, 80, we don't know, but for a long, long time. So just when you thought you were getting rid of the kid, he comes back. So, it's very tempting to stay in that groove that everyone else has created, the consensus reality that's been generated by everybody. It's easier nowadays to get out of that consensus reality because that consensus reality is not being generated by everybody anymore. Now there's many, many consensus realities. So now it's easier to flit from one consensus to the next, trying them on as one likes. How many of you have heard of George Gurdjieff? And you've heard of his disciple, Auspensky? Auspensky was a Russian. Gurdjieff was an Armenian, I think. Don't quote me on that. And Auspensky wrote several books, but his most interesting book, as far as I'm concerned, was called, I can't remember what it was called. It may come back to me. But it was a book that he wrote about Gurdjieff's teaching methods. And this was during the period of roughly 1915 or 16 through about like 1918 or 19. And this was a very critical moment in the history of Russia because, of course, World War I began in what year? 1914. August 1914. And ended when? 18. November of 18. 11/11/18. That's why November the 11th is Veterans Day. It ended on 11/11 at 11/11. And thousands of men were killed in the week up to that. You would have thought, because everybody knew that's when the armistice was, and you would have thought everybody would say, fuck this, and put down their guns and sit around and, you know, drink coffee or something. But they did not, because they were part of the consensus reality of there I am in the trench, and I have to continue, we have to continue firing giant projectiles at one another and killing one another. So in Russia, the war began, and it was absolutely catastrophic for the Russians, whose generals were all completely corrupt, and they lost battle after battle, and there are hundreds of thousands of prisoners and hundreds of thousands of dead. And by 1917, the country was ready for a revolution, which happened, the October Revolution. But it started in March, and anyway, the whole period of time was a complete turmoil in Russia. And Gurdjieff said, this is the perfect time to talk about things that are extremely esoteric, because the consensus reality that is part of a society that is generally intact, that consensus reality is very strong. And even if you are trying to move away from it, it's so strong that it will be very difficult for you to effectively move away from it while you're in it. But when that consensus reality is fragmenting, it's much easier for you to make excursions outside of it, because it's not the gravity of that reality is not holding you as tightly. So just as there is gravity that is holding us like this, there's also subtle gravity that keeps people orbiting around whatever the source of that gravity is, whether it is a czar or a government or a philosophy like communism or any kind of ism, wherever that nugget of solidity is located that things are circulating around, that's the thing that is going to continue trying to draw you in that direction. So Gurdjieff made it a point to teach some of the things that he is most known for, like the Enneagram, for example. During this period, when he could teach it at a time that the consensus reality of the Russian, of Russianness was being fragmented, and eventually became so fragmented that it fell completely to pieces and is only now slowly recovering. So now is a particularly good time to try to be exploring non-standard realities because there's so many consensus realities. In fact, probably the biggest consensus reality today is the not really consensus reality of the internet, because it is something that such a large number of people around the world are connecting into. So it's actually a consensus reality that in some ways is much denser than the previous ones were. Because the previous you had the, you know, the czar, the flag, Mother Russia or whatever, or Mother India or Die Vaterland or whatever it is. Things that were images that everyone probably who had those images, they had slightly different images. Because those images were generally, okay, you had the photo, I mean, you had an image of the czar on the coin or whatever, but most the majority of these images were being generated internally, and they were all different from person to person because they were being generated internally. Now, a vast majority of the images that we have are being generated externally. They're still only images. They're still only photographs. They're still only sound recordings. They're still things that have been taken at a particular time and space with a particular method, a particular causation, and for the purpose of producing a particular effect. But now they're much denser than they used to be because they have been generated in the five element world, in the five Mahabhuta world, instead of in the interior reality where they could be less five Mahabhutaized and more part of the five Tanmata, more living in the world of sound, space, form, taste, and odor, the more refined world. So things are even less refined than they, as if they could have been. Even less refined, but yes, just when we thought they couldn't be any denser and duller and stupider, they can become denser, duller, and stupider because we've decided to take these images that together become a consensus reality and externalize them further. So it's like we had an astral reality already. It was a perfectly good astral reality. There was nothing wrong with it. It wasn't broken. There was no need to fix it. But we generated a new astral reality that is now a fake ersatz human astral reality that is a reflection of the astral reality, which is a reflection of the human reality. So now the reflection is looking at the reflection, and it's one of those two mirrors pointed at one thing, one another kind of thing that are regressing into infinity in both directions, but not just both directions, in an infinity of directions because of the fact that there are so many people doing so many looking at what's looking at who's looking at their, and it's multiplied by the billions of people who are on the internet and who are connecting, who were never on it until recently but are connecting enthusiastically even as we speak. And this is everywhere. This is everywhere, everywhere, everywhere. In the Amazon jungle, far off places of the desert where you think you would never be, they're everywhere. People are connecting to that consensus reality. But it's fragmented. It's externalized. And so this is a perfect moment to try to, even while if you're going to be part of the modern world at all, you have to have some at least vague awareness of the internet, even if you don't spend any time there, because everyone else is on the internet. You can't escape the internet. But you can choose how far you want to stick yourself into the internet, and this may require some experimentation. But how far you need to have your avatar present there without it taking over and then you simply becoming a servant of it. This has always been the problem, with fame especially. With everything else, but especially with fame. That where is that point where once you go beyond, then your persona takes over and you're simply being dragged behind it instead of you having some influence over what's going on with your persona. That used to be a matter of just the people who had enough fame to be worried about that, but now it could be you are minding your own business and you're walking down the street and who knows what happens to you, but somebody catches it on the cell phone and then they post it on the internet and all of a sudden becomes viral, and within a few months, 1 billion people have seen you doing whatever it was you were doing.
Slip on a banana peel.
Exactly. It could be any of those things, you see. And now everybody, and then it was so funny that everybody wants to know who you are, and then all of your info is suddenly, everybody, you know, people in Botswana are talking about it to people in New Guinea, who are talking about it to people in Tierra del Fuego. And all you did was slip on the banana peel or step in the dog poop or whatever it was, and you had no, forget the intention, you had no idea that this was going to happen. But it did. So, what does this mean to purifying the five elements? It means that things are more complicated on the one hand, but they're simpler on the other. More complicated because there are a lot more different directions in which the prana can get can get entrapped, can get tangled up in, can get knotted up in. So many different places where your attention can get trapped. But if you're able to, and this is why pratyahara, keeping your sense organs, generally speaking, inside and trying to avoid letting them go outside except when they need to, it was always important, but it's so much more important nowadays, because that allows you at least to maintain what we hope will be sufficient perspective to keep you from even turning your awareness in certain directions. I am going to stop there for the moment, simply because I see that I've been jawboning for an hour and 40 minutes. An hour and 7 minutes. Any questions? Observations, comments? Criticisms? Witticisms? Apparently not. Okay. Yes?
So, I think Vimalananda said you work with one specific element, didn't he say, and to focus on fire?
Well, Vimalananda, being a practical guy, said, okay, you have the five elements. You're going to work by purifying the five elements. Generally speaking, it's good to purify all five elements. But specifically, in his opinion, it was important, you know, it's sort of like if you're living in a three-dimensional reality, you want to understand both horizontality and verticality and expansivity. So it's very useful to concentrate on one of these elements. He said, generally speaking, trying to concentrate on the earth element as a force for transformation is only going to be useful if you're going to live for 10,000 years or something, because it's a very slow-moving thing, and having it work on transforming you is going to work at the rate that it transforms itself, which is very slowly. And if you try to use the akasha, the element of space, and simply listen to the shabda brahman, that also is very good, but the space element is so rarefied that it may also be difficult for you to work with. He was of the opinion that you should work with one of the three elements that are actually themselves moving, themselves transformative, themselves willing, able, and open to being altered. Those being, of course, water, fire, and air. And air, of course, appears in the human organism as prana, and so there are ways to work with the prana, and we will do some prana circulating exercises for this very purpose, to encourage the prana to circulate nicely, because simply having the prana circulate nicely encourages the nadis to get purified. And if you work with the water, this means, generally speaking, that you are working with some sort of alchemical processes, literal alchemy, or you're working with internal alchemy, meaning purifying the internal juices, the six tastes that Ayurveda has and their relations to the emotions and the food that we eat. And of course, because emotion, in this case, is reflective of the moon, and because the moon is reflective of it reflects the sun. If we take the sun to represent the supreme reality, the moon represents the human ability to reflect the supreme reality, the mind in all of its manifestations. And Vimalananda was fond of saying that you can move towards the supreme reality either by saying, thy will be done, or my will be done. My will be done is the right nostril, me, I will act. The right nostril is all about acting as an individual. And the left nostril is all about receiving and being receptive. And that's the thy will be done. The aspect of bhakti comes from the left nostril. So bhakti meaning devotion. And so devotion is really the best and certainly the easiest, if possibly not the fastest method, except for some very selective individuals, not the fastest method to move in the direction of purifying the water element. And then we have the fire element, which was, and if it was good enough for the rishis, it's good enough for me. That's what I have to say about the fire element. And the fire element is good because the fire element is in the job, I mean, its job is transforming things. So you put things into it and they're transformed. You don't have to wait to see whether this can happen. You can see it right in front of you. Of course, the challenge with the fire element is that you will occasionally get burned. So you should be prepared for that. With the water element, you will occasionally drown. With the air element, you'll occasionally get blown away. So any practice that you undertake, you can, unless you're already a brilliant and completely transformed kind of person, there's going to be a process of, there will be a relationship created. The relationship already exists between you and all these elements, but now it's, up till now, it's the relationship that was built into you as an organism, which is, it's the relationship that is my senses, my sense organs going out there, identifying what's happening with the five elements, bringing back in, and on the basis of that information, having the five elements inside my body do whatever it is they need to do in order to adapt to whatever's happening externally. Whereas now, it would be a matter of, okay, I want to go beyond the five elements to the supreme reality that's beyond them, and I have requested one of these five elements to assist me in that process, and then you are establishing a relationship with that element, and you should be prepared, A, for all the other elements to get jealous and say, wait a minute, it's favoritism, what about the rest of us? And sometimes they might not cooperate as much, and then you have to, of course, be nice to them occasionally also, and when they have a birthday, bring them a cake or something like that, even while you're spending the rest of your time with this other element that you're, and then you have to explain, it's not that I'm more fond of this element than the rest of you, but it's we're working together now, and then that will further cement this relationship that's between you and this other element. And then, of course, that element might get a swelled head and start to think, ha, now I'm the very special element, and then we have to understand that, in fact, I'm working with you, but you're only as a representative of the Tanmatra that is behind you, who is a representative of Tamas, who's a representative of Ahankar, who's a representative of Mahat, who's a representative of Prakriti, who's a representative of Purush. So not to rain on your parade or anything, but You're not quite as, I mean, you're very special to me right now, but I'm going to, at some point, it's going to be, all things will be over, it'll be adios, and we'll go our own separate ways. Bye. So, but you, practically speaking, want to select one of these to work with, and then you establish a relationship with it. And it's, if it's with the fire, you should be aware that sometimes the fire and you will be, it's like any relationship. You will be on a good, there will be a good rapport, you'll be on an even keel. Sometimes it will be the fire saying tomato, and you will say tomato, and there will be a misunderstanding. And you have to also always remember that the fire is a natural force of nature, an F of N. And as a force of nature, you can't get too, you can't anthropomorphize it too much. You can anthropomorphize it a little because that's what humans do. They're anthropomorphizing everything. But you can't push any further than that because it's still a force of nature. If I ever forget this, I have this to remind myself that I got from the Kilauea volcano in Hawaii. I'm very fond of that volcano and of the goddess who lives there, Pele. But this was a good reminder that she is still a volcano and there is a certain limit to which you as, or I as a protoplasmic human being can interact with a volcano. So as long as that is understood by both parties, then something positive can occur. So, that's what we're aiming to have happen.
Immediately, you caught the eyes.
Uh-huh. So, the nice thing is that nature is always awake and alert, and always in the mood to send messages. When she's in the mood to send messages. So, this was a very convenient exclamation point for the comment that was being made at that time. Anyway, we have a little bit of time left before 12 noon. So, may I encourage everyone to sit quietly, close your eyes, take your awareness down to the center of the earth, and take your awareness up to some appropriate point in the sky. Let's just say the sun for right now, since it is, after all, during the day and almost noon. Human beings have been evolved for the purpose of permitting the supreme reality a clear passage all the way down to the center of the earth element, which for us is the center of the earth. On a different planet, it might be somewhere different. But for us, it's the center of the earth. And just like that Trishula, there should be a nice, not rigid, not flopping all around in all directions, but a nice, calm, calmly stable, open channel in which there is a flow of awareness between the center of the earth and the center of the sun. So they can commune together. We then, as human beings, are doing our jobs, which is encouraging the celestial and the terrestrial to meet within us, with us acting as a bridge between the two. So that alignment is happening as we breathe in. That alignment is happening as we breathe out. As a general rule, and this is very general, it depends a lot on you, but as a general rule, the incoming breath is encouraging us to be better centered in our bodies, and the outgoing breath is encouraging us to be less centered in our bodies. So the incoming breath, for right now at least, let's move down and connect to the center of the earth. And the outgoing breath, let us move up and connect to the center of the cosmos, for which right now we're focusing on as if the center of the cosmos was the sun. It is the center of the solar system. So for the earth, the center of the cosmos is, effectively speaking, the sun. As you inhale, you can feel as if you are yourself offering nourishment to the earth element, because she's done so much for us. She keeps us tied down to her so we do not have to worry about flying off into space. We pee all over her, we poop all over her. She doesn't care. She is the Ur Mother, the ultimate in motherhood. And then, as we exhale, we leave the nest and allow the awareness to rise upwards, disconnecting from all the five elements, relinquishing them, letting them remain where they are, but taking the essence of the essence of the essence, moving it up through Sushumna, up through the tip of the Trishula, into the non-solid reality that is the ultimate. So from the greatest amount of manifestation, which we take on and resonate with as we inhale, we release that manifest, the energy of that manifestation, the vibe of that manifestation, as we exhale, and simply allow ourselves to disconnect from the five elements. Here it's good to remember that the five elements are not holding on to you. The five elements are simply available. Each one of us is holding on to the five elements because we're relying on them to do their jobs. The job of the earth element is solidity and stability. Job of the water element is providing, making sure all the tissues are alive and making sure everything is in solution and can flow liquidly around one another. And the fire element is transforming, and the air element is invigorating, and the space element makes some things denser and some things less dense and provides the space in which circulation can occur. And as long as we're reliant on the external world for those five elements, we're going to be attached to the external world. So what we're trying to do is encourage the awareness not to feel that it is obligated to be connected to the external world, but in fact can find whatever it requires in the internal world, then can let all of its needs and wants simply drop away as we focus ourselves in the direction of that supreme reality, which has no limits whatsoever. Another few breaths, and then while we're in this space and you're exploring this space, we will take the advantage of the fact that there are things like mantras that we can employ even while we're visualizing something like this to promote the process. And what better mantra to employ than Om Namah Shivaya? And there's so many different rhythms and melodies that can be employed. So right for now, I propose that we use this melody. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Shivaya Namah. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Shivaya Namah. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Shivaya Namo. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Shivaya Namo. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Shivaya Namo. Om Namah Shivaya.